CLNA update process, revisiting, reflecting, reviewing, and revising, December 17th, 2021. Thank you for joining us on this recorded webinar that will provide eligible recipients important information pertaining to the comprehensive local needs assessment process mandated by Perkins V. I would like to introduce the voices behind this webinar. I am Dr. Melissa K. Wildarczyk-Hickey, and I'm currently the State Director for CTE. Joining me today are Suzanne Vita Loud, Education Consultant, and Kylie Freeman, Associate Education Consultant. As you know, in 2019, the CSDE underwent an intense process to identify Connecticut's career clusters. Nationally, there are 16 clusters. After analyzing data, getting stakeholder feedback, posting for more feedback, 12 emerged. These were identified as agriculture, food, and natural resources, architecture and construction, business management and administration, education and training, finance, health science, hospitality and tourism, information technology, manufacturing, marketing, science, technology, engineering and mathematics, and transportation, distribution, and logistics. The following four were not identified as relevant Connecticut clusters, as they are not an area of occupational growth and/or not high skill, high wage, and in demand in Connecticut: arts, AV, government and public administration, human services, law, public safety. The CLNA process, revisiting and reflecting. One of the most significant changes introduced in Perkins V is the new CLNA process. Specifically, the law states that to receive Perkins V funds, an eligible recipient must conduct a CLNA and update the CLNA not less than once every 2 years. Previously, the CSDE provided guidance on the CLNA process. Using this information, we have created this webinar and will unpack each step, providing questions your team may consider exploring. Section 134C of Perkins V outlines specific requirements regarding the CLNA. Secondary and postsecondary eligible recipients must include the following steps in the CLNA process. One, organize group of stakeholders. Two, analyze student data. Three, analyze labor market data. Four, evaluate current CTE programs. Five, create strategies and actionable activities. As in the first CLNA process, colleges must partner with their regional partner community colleges when conducting the CLNA process to analyze regional data and create strategies to benefit the region as a whole. On this slide is a list of the three regions and the corresponding community colleges. Capital East region includes Capital Community College, Manchester Community College, Middlesex Community College, Quinebaug Valley Community College, Three Rivers Community College. Northwest region includes Asnuntuk Community College, Naugatuck Valley Community College, Northwestern Community College, Tungsis Community College. Shoreline West region includes Gateway Community College, Housatonic Community College, Norwalk Community College. Now I'll have my colleague Kylie tell you about step one.
Perkins V provides a powerful opportunity to consult and coordinate with stakeholders. Meaningful engagement with stakeholders during the CLNA process not only enhances local plans, but also builds partnerships that help CTE programs. And any other stakeholders that the eligible agency may require the eligible recipient to consult. Step one of the CLNA process includes organizing stakeholders. At a minimum, the CLNA process must include engagement with representatives of CTE programs in a local educational agency or educational service agency, including teachers, career guidance and academic counselors, principals and other school leaders, administrators, and specialized instructional support personnel and paraprofessionals. CTE programs at post-secondary educational institutions, including faculty and administrators. Connecticut Workforce Development Boards in a range of local or regional businesses or industries. Parents and students. Special populations. Regional or local agencies serving out-of-school youth, homeless children and youth, and at-risk youth, and Indian tribes and tribal organizations in the state where applicable. As you revisit and reflect on the original CLNA, you may consider asking questions such as, who have we included previously in our CLNA consultation process? Which stakeholders should we include now and or add as we conduct this update? How many meetings and what type, for example, virtual, in-person, are necessary?
Step two of the CLNA process includes analyzing student data. During the first CLNA process, you worked with your stakeholder groups to analyze student data, including levels of performance. Secondary recipients dove deeply into looking at all student data, including those in special populations and for each subgroup. 1S1, four-year graduation rate. 2S1, academic proficiency in reading language arts. 2S2, academic proficiency in mathematics. 2S3, academic proficiency in science. 3S1, post-secondary placement. 4S1, non-traditional program concentration. 5S3, program quality, participated in work-based learning. Post-secondary eligible recipients analyzed data regarding 1P1, post-secondary placement, 2P1, earned recognized post-secondary credential, 3P1, non-traditional program concentration. As you revisit and reflect on the original CLNA data and analyze current data, you may consider asking questions such as, which performance accountability indicator targets are being met? Which student groups are struggling the most in our programs? Which programs or program elements are the least accessible to particular student groups? What have been and are currently the potential root causes of inequities in our CTE system? Which of these root causes were addressed immediately? Which ones needed a more comprehensive long-term plan? Does this plan need to be revised? How are our learners from each special population performing in comparison to students without identified needs at the career cluster and program levels, particularly in programs leading to high skill, high wage, or in-demand sectors or occupations?
The third step of the original and updated CLNA process is to analyze labor market data. Perkins V requires eligible recipients and their stakeholder groups to analyze labor market data and evaluate the alignment between CTE programs offered and the labor market needs of the local area, state, and/or region, now and in the future. As you revisit and reflect on the original CLNA labor market data and analyze current data, you may consider asking questions such as, what state and local labor market sources did we utilize previously? Will we utilize these data during this updated CLNA process? For example, CTDOL statistics, ONET, etc. How is our CTE program aligned to state and local labor market needs? Are changes necessary based on the new data? Which programs, courses should be developed, supported, or phased out?
The final step of the CLNA process is to evaluate current programs. Perkins V requires eligible recipients and their stakeholder groups to analyze the strategies and actionable activities created in previous CLNA process and evaluate whether their current CTE programs meet Connecticut's definition of size, scope, and quality. More information can be found on Perkins V size, scope, and quality requirements on the CSDE Perkins V Today's Skills, Tomorrow's Careers under the Resources on Perkins V tab. During the CLNA update process, as you revisit and reflect current programs, you may consider asking questions such as, how do you continue and or expand post-secondary, dual or concurrent programs, opportunities to earn an industry-recognized credential, work-based learning experiences, involvement of secondary partners, post-secondary partners, and employer or industry partners in the development, implementation, and phasing out or closure of CTE programs, supports for learners who represent special populations. We will now transition from the four-step process to the reviewing and revising of the strategies and actionable activities that resulted as part of the CLNA process.
This year, all eligible recipients must submit a completed Connecticut Perkins V Comprehensive Local Needs Assessment, or CLNA, update document. The template is posted on the CSDE Perkins V Today's Skills, Tomorrow's Careers website under the Resources on the Perkins V tab. The link to the website is provided on this slide by clicking on the bold word CLNA update document or by going to the Career and Technical Education webpage. The document requires eligible recipients to complete six sections, including 1, alignment to local labor market needs, analyze local labor market data site sources, 2, size, scope, and quality of programs offered, strategies and actionable activities, 3, progress toward implementing programs of study, strategies and actionable activities, 4, progress on federal accountability indicators, analyze students' performance data, 5, progress toward improving access and equity, strategies and actionable activities, 6, progress on recruitment, retention, and training of faculty and staff, goals, strategies, and actionable activities. This year, each eligible recipient must submit their completed CLNA update template in EGMS by May 2, 2022. The CLNA update template must be submitted within the Perkins budget modification window and no later than May 2, 2022. The CLNA update documents must be posted in EGMS to the Related Documents section. If you do not have budget modifications, you will still be required to post CLNA update documents to EGMS. Post-secondary may submit one CLNA template document that captures the work of the post-secondary region.
The CSDE CTE unit created a sample CLNA update document, and this webinar will now take you through the sample answers step by step. For purposes of this webinar, we created a fictitious district called Candlewood, and you will see references to Candlewood throughout the rest of these slides.
We will begin with showing a sample for question 2, size, scope, and quality of programs offered, goals, strategies, and actionable activities. After following the CLNA process in 2019-20, Candlewood created a goal for 2020-21. Grow hospitality and tourism career cluster, restaurant, food, services, and beverages based on LMI for the need for catering and banquet managers in our WIB. They created the following strategies and actionable activities to be implemented in 2020-21. Added course 16055, Restaurant Management and Operations, embedded ServSafe IRC into Culinary 1 curriculum, articulated Advanced Culinary 3 with Candlewood Lake Community College CCP program, placed 4 students in paid CWE internships as line cooks, back of the house at Down the Hatch restaurant and pub during 2021 boating season. After conducting a CLNA update this 2021-22 school year, they updated their strategies and actionable activities for 2022 and beyond. Completed the strategies and activities outlined above. Continuing to focus on this career cluster due to its success in engaging students as well as filling the job pipeline. Continuing to expand CWE with new business and industry partners to add more WBL opportunities in the front of the house restaurant management area. Work to establish only one individual as point of contact and student mentor at Down the Hatch to align student experiences to the same performance standards and competencies for demonstration of mastery.
Question 2 requires eligible recipients to answer about their progress towards implementing programs of study. After following the CLNA process in 2019-20, Candlewood created a goal for 2020-21, add new cluster manufacturing. The strategies and actionable activities implemented in 2020-21 included write new curriculum for introduction to process manufacturing course, provide technology education teacher with professional learning at CCAT and Sikorsky Aircraft. After concluding the updated CLNA process, they adjusted their strategies and actionable activities for 2022 and beyond. Add Board of Education approved course to program of studies for 2021-22. Write curriculum for process manufacturing 2 course. Establish a new chapter of Skills USA to target this cluster. Investigate work-based learning and the Young Manufacturers Pipeline Initiative to promote student internships in the summer of 2023. Recruit an individual from industry to teach at Candlewood under an 098 certificate endorsement to ensure that all aspects of an industry are covered in what will be an increasingly technical program of study.
As mentioned previously, Perkins V requires eligible recipients to dig deep into data regarding subgroups and special populations. For question 4, Candlewood reported on their progress on federal accountability indicators, goals, strategies, and actionable activities. They have 2 goals. This goal for 2021 is to increase graduation rate of concentrators from military families. Strategies and actionable activities implemented in 2020-21. Disaggregated and analyzed student data gathered internally by PowerSchool records as EdSite link not open. Graduation data for CTE concentrators continue to exceed non-concentrators despite impact of COVID-19 on CTE applied learning opportunities. Students of military families did not exceed and they are not graduating at the same rate of their peers. Assigned a school mentor to each senior student currently in a military family. After conducting the updated CLNA process this school year of 2021-22, Candlewood shared the following. Updated strategies and actionable activities for 2022 and beyond. Shift to data mining strictly from EdSite as Secure Link is now up and running. Investigate establishment of CTE Honor Society and Diploma Seal of CTE to promote importance and buy-in from students and families for CTE coursework completion and keep concentrator numbers high. Continue school mentor program to support juniors and seniors currently in military families. Their second goal was goal for 2020-21 to increase performance level of concentrators who are Hispanic females in the STEM and manufacturing clusters. Strategies and actionable activities implemented in 2020-21. Analyze student data gathered internally by PowerSchool records. District non-traditional enrollment data exceeds required performance level. Non-traditional performance data for Hispanic female concentrators is below performance level. Implemented coursework and student material, including non-traditional role models at both the secondary and middle school levels. After conducting their updated CLNA process, Candlewood's updated strategies and activities for 2022 and beyond. Shift to data mining strictly from EdSite as SecureLink is now up and running. Held professional training for high school and middle school teachers and counselors on recruitment and retention of female students in STEM fields. Created a team and participated in CCAT and CSTE STEM manufacturing professional learning activity. Include data and information about STEM opportunities in at least 3 district newsletters.
For question 5, progress on improving access and equity, goals, strategies, and actionable activities, Candlewood identified the following goals for 2020-21. Present and recommend that Candlewood Board of Education remove GPA requirement and teacher recommendation criteria from CCP course enrollment process. Use Carl D. Perkins funds for expanded after-school certification programs for CTE students with 504 plans or IEPs. They outlined the following strategies and actionable activities implemented in 2020-21. GPA requirements for CCP enrollment removed, EMT basic course offered to 504 and IEP students with 5 students enrolled and sitting for examination. After conducting the CLNA update process, they listed the following updated strategies and actionable activities for 2022 and beyond. Add additional sections of CCP courses due to increased enrollments, engage in targeted outreach to students and families with 504 plans or IEPs in order to increase enrollment for EMT basic after-school programs from 5 students to 10 students, work to connect each EMT basic student with a mentor who will meet with the student at least 4 times over the school year.
For question 6, progress on recruitment, retention, and training of faculty and staff, goals, strategies, and actionable activities, Candlewood outlined the goal for 2020-21. Encourage and support all new CTE teachers to participate in either the Science Center Externship Program, the CCAT PLC Program, or the Universal Design for Learning webinars in order to promote establishment of collegial relationships and bring new pedagogy into their classrooms. And listed the following strategies and actionable activities implemented in 2020-21. One team of CTE teachers participated in the Science Center Externship Program and presented on their experience at a faculty meeting. No new CTE teacher in STEM or manufacturing, so CCAT does not apply. 3 new CTE teachers participated in the CAST UDL and then presented new learning for CTE curriculum writing at a faculty meeting. After conducting the updated CLNA process, they updated strategies and actionable activities for 2022 and beyond. Continue work with the industry partners assigned to our CTE team at the externship program. Use Perkins funds to send the CTE teachers who completed the CAST UDL training for train-the-trainer workshops in order to help them write or update existing curriculum. Please note that although Candlewood did not change their goals for 2021-22, you may. Their data supported the continuation and expansion of their original goals. If your data suggests that changes need to be made to the goal or goals set for 2020-21, please note that in the box provided.
Thank you for joining us on this pre-recorded webinar. Additional information on CTE and Perkins V is available on the Connecticut State Department of Education website.
If you have any questions related to the CLNA and/or Perkins, please contact us. Dr. Melissa Hickey, State Director of CTE, Suzanne Loud, CTE Consultant, Harold Mackin, CTE Consultant, Kylie Freeman, CTE Associate Consultant. Once again, thank you.